from the house of the Lord, we bless you. The Lord is God, and he has made his light shine on us. With bows in hand, join in the festal procession up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will praise you. You are my God, and I will exalt you. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Lord God, we gather in the house today to say thank you for being our God. We declare that you are our God and we are your people, and we have come today to worship you. We thank you, Lord, that you have kept us to this time. We thank you that you have provided all we need. And we just ask, Lord God, yea, now we invoke your holy name and say, have your way in this service. In this place today, oh God, be glorified. Lord, let your glory shine in this house and in all of us, so that people will look on us and know that we serve a living God. We thank you, Lord God, for your goodness and mercy towards us. We thank you for your mercies that are new every morning. And so, oh God, we submit ourselves to you, and we invite you, God, to use us so that you, oh Lord, will be glorified in each one. Thank you, oh God. As we further wait on you, have your way in the name of Christ Jesus, our Savior. Amen. Hallelujah. God has been good to us.
Amen.
Amen. And we do not hold back our praise. We give God all thanks and praise. Hallelujah. For who he is and for his great love for us. I just want to take a moment to welcome any of our first-time visitors. Looks like we have all family in the house this morning. Do we have any first-time visitors? No, I don't. We do? Amen. If you want to rise and tell us your name and where you're from, no pressure, you don't have to. Amen. Well, we're just going to sing our welcome song so that you are welcome in this place. Turn to your neighbor and say, you're welcome. Hallelujah. For those grieving the loss of loved ones, we of course funeralized our brother Lenny Sparks on Friday. So we want to continue to pray for Sister Bev and the family. And of course, Deacon Bruce Williams from Copperfoot Road was funeralized earlier in the week. Prepare your hearts now to bring an offering to the Lord. Remembering that giving is a part of our worship, and we give God our very best gift. The Word of God, which I'm going to be using as a reference in the sermon today, says, when you sow sparingly, you reap sparingly. But when you sow bountifully, you reap bountifully. And so we give according as we have purposed in our hearts, not begrudgingly or out of necessity, but because we love the Lord. We give because the Lord loves a cheerful giver. And we give in recognition that everything we have comes from God,
He is the provider of all. Amen. Deacon Daye is going to come and offer prayer. Can I have those plates, please?
Let us pray. Our gracious, our loving Heavenly Father, we come this morning singing your praises, God. Hallelujah. Hosanna to God. Oh, glory to your name, Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for your many blessings, God. We thank you, God, that we are here this morning, that we can sing your praises and worship you. Father God, we come now to give you the offerings, the tithes that we have, and we ask you, God, to bless these, that they may be used to your honor and to your kingdom building here on earth. We thank you and we praise your name, and it is in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. Amen.
Cause I can't even walk.
Now to go for the Lord in prayer. We are grateful that we are able to take all of our joys and our sorrows to the Lord. When the choir is going to come, I reminded you about those who we funeralized in this past week or so. I want to remind you of those that we have those who are sick among us, and we want to continue to pray for our brother Harold Adam and for Brother Primrose States. That God continues to watch over and keep them in his care. And we continue to pray for Sister Jan Moir and Sister Sharon Adams, and of course, Brother Bubby Adams. And you may know of others who are sick. Let's continue to lift them up and give God thanks for the joys. But remember that we can bring to him everything. Amen?
Amen.
The choir will sing, and then Minister Thornton will come and lead us in prayer.
Oh.
children crying in the temple, saying, "Hosanna to the Son of David." They were so displeased. This morning we can say, "Hosanna, Hosanna." I'm going to make a little phrase. I hope I got it right. And it goes like this. Baruch haba b'shem Adonai. Simply means, the Lord is coming. Father, we thank you this morning for your grace, your mercy, your goodness. We thank you that you rode into a city one time on a donkey with its colt. But Lord, even then, we were on your mind. We thank you, Lord, for this glorious day in remembrance of an event that was possible, has set us free. There are so many events that happen during this time of year, Lord, but we're grateful that this one happened. Hosanna, we can say, Hosanna. Salvation has come to this house and to every life this day. Father, we thank you that you've taken care of us through the week. We ask you, Lord, to forgive us. I don't know about others, Lord, but I know this week that's passed. Even this morning, Lord, there was a couple sins, Lord, I didn't quite get involved like I should have. But I confess to you now and ask your forgiveness. Lord, because you said that if we confess our sins, your faithful is just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Thank you for those wonderful promises, Lord, that are true. Father, we thank you for the week that's passed. There's been sadness in our communities, and yet in the midst of it, Lord, there's been joy. Some of those who have passed, Lord, are now in your presence, enjoying the flavor and the joy of meeting the one to whom they gave their lives to and who gave his life for their life. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for those that are still struggling with issues. You heard the names that were mentioned. Father, we would ask in Jesus' name that you would stretch forth your hand, because you are Jehovah Rapha, the Lord that does heal. And so, Lord, bring healing. Maybe it's to be permanently, maybe it's just for a moment. Bring relief to those right now from this house, Lord, that need to know your presence right now. Thank you, Lord, for those who have recently been saved. I thank you, Lord, that they're still growing, still learning, still trusting you, Lord. Father, thank you for the people who are still struggling with this COVID. Father, in the name of Jesus, we ask, Lord, that you'd break the power of this disease, this plague, whatever term you put on it. But Lord, if it fits into the purpose that you have for your world and for the coming of your Son, then Lord, do what you will. Father, we anticipate any moment, Lord, your coming for us. We don't say it often, Lord, but we anticipate. But Lord, in the meantime, we need your strength. We need your wisdom. We need your heart mending our hearts. Lord, I'm not sure everything I want to pray this morning, but I thank you for this house right now. I thank you for new horizons, Lord. I thank you, Lord, that we are a new name. And I pray that each one of us, Lord, will have ourselves renewed by the grace of God. Lord, I pray in Jesus' name for every one of us that you'll do a revival in each one of our hearts. That God, when people see us, they will see Christ in us, the hope of glory. Help us, Lord, to love one another. Someone's got some struggles going on in this house today. And so, Lord, help us to be charitable. Maybe we can't always say it, but Lord, we sure can pray for one another. For Lord, you said the effectual fervent prayer of a believer does much good. So Lord, help us to pray one for another. And for those who are not with us this morning, who are convalescing, Lord, we pray, restore strength to them. Restore vitality to them. Father, we also pray for those first responders, the people in hospitals, doctors, nurses, the cleaners, and all that have been responsible for facing this pandemic, Lord, grant them grace, that general grace that you provide. Thank you, Lord, for those who have been willing, Lord, to put themselves in that position. Thank you for those who have loved ones that are in nursing homes or in places of confinement, and we pray for them, Lord, today. We thank you for our members of our own household. Comfort them today. May they know that at this very moment, your hand of grace and goodness is still there, because you promise never to leave us, never to forsake us. What a glorious promise you've given to us. Lord, I just think about that, and it brings joy to my heart, that you will never leave us. You will never forsake us. Oh, my God. In this world in which we're living, Lord, things change, but Lord, what a promise. But thank you, Lord, that one day you rode into Jerusalem. And so, Lord, let our hearts cry out to you today with thanksgiving and with joy. Hosanna, Hosanna. Blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord. And you've come to new horizons this morning. Also pray, Lord, for your servant that comes to bring a word this morning, God. May every heart be open to hear. And Lord, as we hear, we respond to hear what the Spirit is saying unto the church. And then, Lord, after we've heard it, and help us to be able to say amen. What a good word from God. And so, Father, we thank you for gathering us together this day. And we bless you and we praise you. We give you honor and we give you glory. For you are worthy of our praise. And let the church just say amen.
Amen.
Praise God.
Take it to the Lord in prayer. Thank you, Minister Thornton, for that wonderful reminder that the Lord says he will never leave us or forsake us. Hallelujah. No matter what we're going through in this life, we can rejoice in that truth. We are not in it by ourselves. Bless God for God's faithfulness to us, and we pray that we would be a faithful people to the Lord. The Word of God comes from our traditional text for Palm Sunday, Matthew 21, verses 6 through 11. Hear the Word of the Lord. Reading from the New International Version. Matthew 21, verses 6 through 11. The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest!" When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred. The whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" And the crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I want to add as a subtext this morning the verse I referenced earlier from 2 Corinthians 9:6 that says, "When you sow sparingly, you reap sparingly. But those who sow bountifully reap also bountifully." Amen?
Amen.
Today on this Palm Sunday, we wrap up our study of the spiritual disciplines. Consider this traditional Palm Sunday text and meditate with me on the thought as you think of that subtext. You reap what you sow. You reap what you sow. Let us pray. Lord God, now in this the moment of proclamation, we invite you to open up this word to our understanding, and our hearts are ever grateful, God, that you care enough to send us a word. We pray, Lord, that it takes root in us, not only that we hear it with our ears, but we hear it with our hearts. Let it take root in us so that it might grow and bring forth fruit for the kingdom. We thank you and stand on your truth that says, when your word goes out, it does not return unto you void, but accomplishes the purpose for which it has been sent. And so we invite you to do a work in us today. Have your way. Let me decrease now so that you would increase and the word come forth as you would have it. In the mighty and matchless name of Jesus Christ, amen. You know, just a little aside, I can't come to Palm Sunday service and read the text about Jesus on the back of a donkey without thinking of Sister Margaret Sparks. Ride on, King Jesus. Hallelujah. God rest her soul. Hallelujah. In this last installment on the spiritual disciplines, allow me to quickly recap for you. We began with the discipline of prayer, understanding that prayer is conversation with God. It is dialogue, not monologue. We share with God what is on our hearts and minds, and God shares with us God's heart and mind. In prayer, we build our relationship with God. In prayer, we express our gratitude for who God is and all that God has done. Gratitude is a state of being, a discipline that can be cultivated so that one can become more and more grateful in heart and spirit. With prayerful and grateful hearts, we enter into meditation on the study of God's word. Sorry, into meditation on and the study of God's word. The scriptures give us precepts for living and help us to understand more about God in the fullness of the Godhead, the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, one God in three persons. It is revealed to us more and more as we read and study the Word of God. To truly meditate and study the Word, we need to discipline ourselves to wait on God and listen for God's Spirit speaking to us in times of silence and solitude. We live in a noisy, busy world, but just as Jesus took time to withdraw from the crowds and to withdraw from his disciples, we too must find time to steal away to Jesus so that we may more clearly hear what God is saying. It is in those times of silence and solitude that we learn what it means to submit to God and the working of God's will in us. The discipline of submission is being able and willing to relinquish all we are and all we have into God's hands. Putting aside our selfish tendencies and desires, even when we think we are doing something good for God. Obedience to the Holy Spirit of God is better than the offerings we make according to our flawed understanding. It is not up to us to determine what we think God wants. We must listen and obey the Spirit of the Lord. And that brings us to today's text. In this pericope, we see the working out of God's will through the actors in this part of the Jesus story. In Jesus, we see the perfect example of our last discipline, service. Service. Returning to Jerusalem under threat of death is an act of service. Riding this donkey in keeping with the prophecy in Zechariah is an act of service. The people do not realize it yet, but Jesus is coming to them in the ultimate act of service. This service that Jesus exemplifies is complete submission to God to do as God sees fit. It is the embodiment of the command to deny ourselves. The ride into Jerusalem is the beginning of the Lord's example of what it means to unconditionally trust in God. Jesus shows us how to give ourselves over in service to God through our service to others. Jesus shows us how to give ourselves over in service to God through our service to others. When we talk about the discipline of service, Richard Foster in his book, I mentioned it to you before, Celebration of Discipline, makes a distinction between self-righteous service and true service. Self-righteous service is rooted in human effort that expends tremendous amounts of energy in figuring out how we can, you know, help those people. True service is prompted by God and then energized by God. It's kind of like when we talk about the principles of it, restorative justice. I don't know if you, the leadership remembers, we had a retreat and we had a teaching on restorative principles and ways of working in a restorative kind of way. And the mantra that I had Deacon Daye shouting with pom-poms as our cheerleader was, not to, not for, but with. With, when we come alongside others to say, how is it that I can help you? Not telling you what you need to do, not telling you what I'm gonna do for you, but asking you, how can I come alongside with you? And so this whole idea of with is about serving in a way that comes alongside, not using your energy to say, what can I do for those to help those people, right? True service is prompted by God and then energized by God. It is not the same frantic energy of the flesh. Self-righteous service is to impress and usually seeks big venues. True service is fine with not being noticed and serving in obscurity. There is little to no distinction between the large and small because it is all to the glory of God and not to the one doing the serving. Self-righteous service needs people to see and notice. It requires external rewards. But true service is its own reward because it is service to God. Foster says true service does not fear lights and attention, but does not seek it and does not require it to continue to do the work. There is joy and satisfaction when we ask, as my cousin Reverend Hawkins once said, have I made God smile today? Have I made God smile today? And determine that you won't let a day pass that you don't make the Lord smile. Self-righteous service picks and chooses whom to serve, is affected by moods and whims, I don't feel like it today, and can actually be destructive because it is focused on recognizing the individual giving the service. But true service ministers faithfully because there is a need. It doesn't matter what you feel like. You want to give your all to the Lord. because there is a need. Submission to spiritual authority is not problematic for those who desire to render true service to God. If Jesus had asked the disciples to go get a donkey and they had refused, perhaps because they thought they could keep him out of Jerusalem and therefore out of harm's way, remember, they didn't want to go back. When Jesus said, "We're going to Jerusalem," they said, "What? They tried to kill you the last time." So they could have thought, "He doesn't know what he's saying. We're going to help the brother out, and we're not going to get any donkey." But they would have been doing a disservice to God and to humankind. Because sometimes we don't know what the Lord wants to do with what God has asked us to do. We just need to do it. Hallelujah. When Holy Spirit tells you to do it, you need to do it. They may have had good intentions by not getting that donkey, but obedience to God through submission to the one God sent is the mark of true service. True service is born out of our love of God and our desire to serve God no matter what it costs us. No matter how we reason it out, no matter what our thoughts are on the issue, serving God requires us to lay aside our agendas and follow what God wants us to do. You reap what you sow. The Lord's triumphal entry into Jerusalem, as described in the gospel accounts, sounds like a one-man parade with throngs of people shouting and praising God, "Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest." But we know those throngs, throwing down palm branches and cloaks before him and calling him king, will soon be calling for his crucifixion. On the outside, to the natural eye, they look like they are adoring worshipers. But what is going on in their hearts? Sincere hearts are hearts of service to the Lord we profess to love. In a devotional I'm reading this week, the author, who is a worship leader, uses the praise team as an easily visible example of true service. He asks, quote, "When you come into the house of God to worship, fellowship, and be fed by the word of God, do you truly worship God? Yes, you may know the words by heart and sing the harmony in perfect pitch. You may even close your eyes and lift up your hands, but that does not mean you are worshiping God. It simply means you know the motions." End quote. And actually he goes on to say, quote, "If you are attempting to get noticed, then you have your reward. A few pats on the back from people near you on how well you can sing melody. However, true worship is a matter of the inner adoration of a person towards his maker, not a series of outward actions. God has never been one to look at the outer man or woman. God desires intimacy more than imitation." End quote. God desires intimacy more than imitation. Church, I remind you, God is a watcher of hearts. Are you offering God a heart of worship? Are you giving God a heart of service? Ministers, deacons, or worship team members, we are very visible. Though we may not necessarily know every single person in the church, most of them know us, or at least they are watching us. Little things we do get magnified. When you lift your hands in worship, they watch. When you greet them at the door, they watch, they notice. And when in a moment of weakness you trip and fall, Lord have mercy, you do so in plain sight. People are watching and need to see true and faithful witnesses of Christ in every situation. In every season, we must exemplify hearts of true service. Speaking of true service and positive witness, are your conversations away from the church edifying to the body? Is what you posted on social media appropriate for the rest of the congregation to see? Is what you're doing going to cause someone to stumble if they saw you? No matter how lowly you think of your position at the church, remember Jesus said to all of his followers, "You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden." How many times does it make you cringe when people who say they're Christians, when they are clergy people who are promoting different things on social media, when they are encouraging people not to follow what the authorities have said, when they are the ones who are spewing racist talk, when they're the ones who are stirring up evil in the world? It should make you cringe as a follower of Christ to say that these people claim to be followers also. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden. Everybody is watching. And they are really watching the church in times like these. Jesus made his way back to Jerusalem, aware that the same crowds that would praise him when he entered the city would be calling for his execution a few days later. He knew one of his closest friends would betray him and another would deny him three times. But in submission and service to God, Jesus came. We cannot be Christians only when it suits us or only when things are going smoothly or going our way. Our faith and trust in God are the most important when things are not going great. That is when we are called to be his the most. That is when we need to stand up and be his witnesses. That is why Jesus told Peter to be faithful and believe that God answers prayer. God alone can give us the strength to be his under every circumstance. To be patient or forgiving or gracious as the situation calls for. We are his disciples. We are his witnesses. We are his servants. No matter what, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. The service that you give is a part of that light. The light of your witness includes your service. If you only talk about Jesus, but do nothing to embody your professed faith and trust, you are not being a true witness. The last point I implore you to give thought to is Luke 12, 48b. To whom much is given, much is required. We have been blessed to be a blessing. Blessing others in sincere service to God is the best use of the time, talent, and treasure God has entrusted to you. Let me say that again. Blessing others in sincere service to God is the best use of the time, talent, and treasure God has entrusted to you. The Lord has entrusted believers. He has entrusted you with the opportunity to serve him, to serve with a sincere heart, desiring to give God all the glory. For it is we who are the circumcision, we who serve God by his Spirit, who boast in Christ Jesus, and who put no confidence in the flesh. Jesus said in Mark 10:45, even the Son of Man did not come to serve, but did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. The spiritual disciplines we have been exploring prepare us for service to God, service to the kingdom, with a sincerity of heart and goodwill towards our fellow human beings. The disciplines teach us how to yield ourselves over to God for God to use as God will. They teach us to take the focus off ourselves and put our focus squarely on God and what God desires. When we can release ourselves into God's hands, trusting God for the outcome, we can be relieved of the stress and striving and start striding. Remember that? Not striving, striding in the path God lays out before us. We can be unburdened of lives that are focused solely on ourselves. The alternative to a self-focused life is a selfless life in which you sow into the expansion of the kingdom of God. Again, you, those who sow sparingly reap sparingly, but those who sow bountifully reap bountifully. You reap what you sow. We often think of that in a negative way. Like people say it as one, you reap what you sow. Yeah. But it's also a very positive thing, yeah. Right? If you're sowing very positive things. The word of God says that Jesus was obedient unto death, even death on a cross, so that now God has highly exalted him. He has the name above all names. Because he sowed obedience. He sowed obedience to God. He reaped what he sowed. If you want a great harvest, sow. Sow. And sow some more into the ministry God has set before you. So willingly, by serving God with your whole heart. Be disciplined in your service, remembering that God rested on the seventh day and calls us to do the same so that we do not burn out. So being mindful that God can take your little and make it much. So in gratitude. So in prayer, so in meditation and study, so in silence and solitude, so in submission, as we see in Jesus today, headed into Jerusalem, knowing the fate that awaits him. Jesus rode into Jerusalem knowing that his time was coming. He came anyway. He came to offer his life for ours. He came to redeem us. He came to save us. And the whole time, he did not focus on himself. He focused on serving us. Amid shouts of Hosanna, Jesus rode, knowing that praise would soon turn. He never stopped loving. He never stopped caring. He never stopped healing. He never stopped teaching. He never stopped serving. He sowed into the kingdom until the end. So with all that you are and all that you have, giving yourself over into God's hands. So trusting God for the outcome. So knowing God will never leave you or forsake you. So knowing that you are more than a conqueror in Christ Jesus. So believing that nothing you do for God goes unnoticed by God. Amen. So knowing only what you do for Christ will last. So telling the world by your action that there is one worthy of our praise and only one. So in praise and adoration to the one who created you and has a plan for your life. So knowing that God has designed good works for you to do. He designed them long ago, knowing that you were coming. So seeking to bring God your very best gifts. So to honor God. So to glorify God. So to exalt God. So to edify the church of God. So to be his witnesses in season and out of season. So until you cannot go anymore. Not from weariness, but because the Lord has called you home. I will serve the Lord all the days of my life, to the very end. So, because church, when you sow sparingly, you reap sparingly. But when you sow bountifully, Lord have mercy. You can't beat God-giving. You reap also bountifully. So in service, church, believing that you reap what you sow. Amen. It's not a bad thing. Hallelujah. Jesus said, I'm coming back and my reward is with me. And I don't know about you, but I want to be among those who receive a reward from God. Hallelujah. It doesn't matter what man says. What matters is what the Lord says. We serve the Lord. We do what we do for the glory of God and not for our own vain glory. Hallelujah. We bless God for the privilege of serving, even when we don't feel like it. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. If you're here this morning and you have not given your life to the Lord, if you don't enjoy the security of knowing that Jesus came back right this very moment, you would go back with him, then I invite you to come. He came riding in on the donkey in Jerusalem that day, heading to Calvary's cross by the end of the week to die on that cross for you and for me, to redeem us, to give us a place in eternity in his glory as it was always meant to be. So that when we pass from this life, we pass to our eternal life. But not only that, Jesus gave us power for living through his resurrection. He overcame death, hell, and the grave.
Yes. Yes.
And every believer has his spirit living in them. So that as we face the challenges of the day, we can draw on the power of God. If you're here this morning and you haven't given him your life, if you haven't given him your heart, as the choir sings, we invite you to come.
His brother. wants to rededicate her life to the Lord and be baptized through New Horizons.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Give God praise. Joanne Davis, yes. Rededicating her life to the Lord, yes, today and wanting to be baptized at New Horizons Baptist Church. Amen. Amen. We bless God for you, my sister. We will be in prayer. Reverend Grace will get all of your information so that we can continue to have conversation. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Please receive the benediction. Hallelujah. Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before his presence in glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power from this time forth and even forevermore. Amen. Blessed be the rock of our salvation.